delighted to be back for a return engagement. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
Good, good. How many of you were here for our May presentation? Oh, so just a few of you. So we'll rehash everything that we talked about for that presentation, and then we'll also talk to you about some of the new things that we're finding that are quite exciting. My name is Dr. Ashley Oliphant. This is my mama. Her name is Beth Yarbrough. If you can't hear it in my mouth to tell, I'm from North Carolina, and she is too. We are delighted, however, to be in the land of good barbecue. We got some good barbecue in North Carolina, but holy cow. No pun intended. I'm a fan of the brisket. I'm going to put on a few Texas pounds while I'm here, but we're not here to talk to you about brisket. We're here to talk to you about Jean Laffite, and we'll get to that in just a minute, but we'll tell you a little bit about ourselves before we get going so you'll know. As I said, this is Beth. She is my road trip sidekick. We find all kinds of trouble when we are out on research adventures together. She is an artist, a pretty well-known one. If you've ever been in Hobby Lobby or Walmart or Target or Cracker Barrel or any of those places, you have probably walked by something that she painted and you didn't know it. She is a licensed artist, so she paints the pretty things, and then companies put them on things like shower curtains and coffee mugs and garden flags and such. So she has a 40-year career in the art licensing industry. Eight years old, right out of the gate, so that's sort of been her trajectory. I, on the other hand, am a recently retired English professor. I taught for 20 years, also started when I was 8, and 20-year career in higher education, taught at UNC Charlotte, UNC Greensboro, most recently 14 years at Pfeiffer University, all in North Carolina. And 20 years in college classroom will make you tired. So I had written several books, and I'll talk to you about those here in just a second, and realized that what I really wanted to do was be a researcher and a writer. So retired in May, and it was really a necessity because what we have discovered is America wants to hear about Jean Laffite, and we are getting calls from all over the country to come and speak, and I was not going to be able to give first-year writers the attention that they need while I was being pulled here and there. So it was a good move. But let us tell you a little bit about our books. My mom just published another book in the earlier this fall. It's called Higher Ground. She's actually, in addition to being a painter, a photographer. You may have been familiar with her blog. It's called southernvoice.net. She takes pictures, glorious pictures, of the beautiful structures of the South, many of which are deteriorating and their stories are being lost. And she takes the pictures and tells the stories. So southernvoice.net is something you might want to check out if you like historical things. And her book, Higher Ground, actually takes pictures of the beautiful churches of the South, many of which are in Texas, and tells their stories. So look that up online. I started out with my first little book, and all of these will be for sale at the end of our talk today. I'm an English professor, but I wrote a science book as my first attempt. I'm a fossil expert when it comes to shark's teeth, of all things. This book's called Shark Tooth Hunting on the Carolina Coast. But if you are a shark tooth hunter, the species that you would find on the Gulf Coast are going to be represented here. So these make great Christmas gifts for people you know who might be beachcombers. So All Color Guide will help you determine the species. It's a lot of fun, and it somehow sold 15,000 copies, and I'm not quite sure how. People like sharks. So take a look at this if you're interested. I also wrote a novel that is called In Search of Jimmy Buffett, A Key West Revival. It is a comedy. He has not yet sued me for using his name and likeness without his express written consent, which is cool. But it's a comedy about hating your job and quitting it and moving to Key West to do what you really want to do. So if you can relate to that in any way, this would be a good book for you. I will also add, she's going to hit me in the side if I don't say this, there is an absolutely neurotic mother in this book who she wants me in every presentation to say is not her. So, no idea where she found it. Complete fiction. So, if you like Jimmy Buffett, The Ocean, or Smiling, this would be a good book for you. And then lastly, my actual real job was being a Hemingway scholar, and so that's what my dissertation was about. And there aren't a whole lot of young women writing about Hemingway, and so that door needs to be kicked down. I'm delighted to be the one to do it. This is called Hemingway and Bimini, The Birth of Sport Fishing at the End of the World. It is the story of how big game fishing became a sport in the Bahamas in the 1930s, in Bimini more specifically, and how Hemingway and his buddies were integral in its formation and actually formed the International Game Fish Association. Most people don't know that Hemingway was involved in that. So if you or someone you love is into big game fishing, this is the book for you. I got to go to Bimini and learn how to fish for big game for research, which was fun. And I also got to interview the last living men who fished with Hemingway. Two of which died very shortly after I got their stories. So it was a fun project. If you can work it to go to the Bahamas for your career, like, do that. This is how you have fun with what you're doing. But we are here today to talk to you about Jean Laffite Revealed. How many of you had sort of heard about the book before you saw the presentation announcement go up? Good, a fair number. We got interested in this issue because we are from the green dot on the map there. That is Lincolnton, North Carolina, just outside of Charlotte. And there was, in 1839, this really mysterious Frenchman named Lorenzo Ferrer who showed up in our town, and none of what he said made sense. He had all this money. He was French. There weren't a whole lot of French people in this area of North Carolina at that time. And he, you know, sort of explained to people where he had come from, and there were many different stories, and none of them quite lined up. And even in his day, there were people who said, I think this guy might be Jean Laffite instead of Lorenzo Ferrer, but the rumblings never sort of amounted to anybody being able to prove it, especially after he died. And so there is a grave in Lincolnton, Lorenzo Ferrer's grave, and people sort of affectionately call it the pirate's grave, but nobody was able to prove, like, is it really or is it not? And so I knew that I wanted my next book to be a new biography of Jean Laffite, because nothing new or particularly innovative has been written about him in about 80 years. And again, there aren't a whole lot of women writing about pirates, and I wanted to down another door. You'll see a theme there. She kicks doors down too, just so you know. But it's not just me. But we were in New Orleans on a family trip, beginning for me to be able to look in the archives there to begin to research that biography. We were eating lunch at Antoine's, which was absolutely perfect if you've never been. And she said, you know, Ashley, that Lorenzo Ferrer story in Lincolnton, you might want to do a chapter in your book. Let's do a little research and see if there's more that we can find. Maybe give that story the truth or the not truth stamp for people to recognize. And so we started together to do the research, and it took us, what was it, maybe 15 minutes to determine, like, there's a lot more to this story that researchers have not found yet. We knew very quickly that that needed to be what this book was going to be about, and that we needed to write it together. So not a lot of mother-daughter research teams on the road these days, but we're happy to be one of them. So to tell you a little bit about Laffite, and I probably don't need to tell you too much because you are Galveston after all, but for those of you who really may, like, legitimately not know, Jean Laffite popped up in Louisiana around 1805. That's the first document that we have. And he was a pirate, a person looking to make money from stealing. And his particular skill set was in establishing a market amongst people who would consistently buy his things. And so we know nothing about his earliest years, where he was born, who his parents were, who his family was. There are people to claim that they know. They do not have documents to prove it. So any of those sort of early claims about he was this, he was that, we truly do not know, nobody does. But the picture does become more clear once you get into Louisiana. And he set up shop in the Barataria Swamps, which are south of New Orleans, an area where there was already an enclave of pirates who Laffite recognized could just use a little bit of help from a leader to get super organized, and there was a ton more money to be made than they were making. And so he essentially established one of the most successful black markets that has ever been seen in America. At the peak of his success, he was the one of the top 10 wealthiest men in America, all based on things he stole. And his warehouses down in those swamps housed millions of dollars in merchandise from the perspective of early 1800s money, which is it's just astonishing. There's no other way to put it. Now, I always want to pause here to explain, for those of you who don't know, and for risk of us glorifying a guy who was truly not good, that part of the merchandise that was brought into Barataria was a result of slave ships being attacked. And so Laffite was a slave trader, and our guess is that thousands of enslaved people were sold into very horrific circumstances in America because of his business. So he was a thief, he was a liar, and he was a smuggler of human beings. So I know Johnny Depp sort of, you know, with the Pirates of the Caribbean, we get this picture of what piracy was. That's not who Laffite was, and we always want to sort of acknowledge the suffering that was caused by his business, so to speak. And so we know, again, a lot about what happened in New Orleans, but the really interesting part of the New Orleans story of Laffite is the Battle of New Orleans. So for those of you who don't know that history, the British were kind of swirling around out there in the Gulf and looking for a way to come in and to kick America's behind. And they had the manpower, they had the ships, they had the weapons to be able to do so. Andrew Jackson gets called down, this is War of 1812, he gets called down to try to help defend that part of the country, and realizes, oh, SpaghettiOs, like, this is not going to be good. And there was a great need for manpower and for weaponry, particularly flints. The British made the mistake of pulling in the Barataria to try to make Laffite an offer, a very substantial offer, for his assistance. If he would throw the men that he had under his control, which at that point numbered about 1,000, and he had 100 ships at his disposal, he would be given a commission in a position in the Navy, the British Navy, and be given a whole heap of money. He decided to not side with the British and immediately skittered into New Orleans to tell anybody in authority who would listen, they're coming, they're trying to get me to help them, you need to know what's about to happen. So it took some convincing, but finally Andrew Jackson, Claiborne, the governor, and a couple of other guys were like, all right, yes, they're pirates, yes, we don't want to deal with them, but we're going to have to. And so it was Laffite's flints, most scholars agree, that really assisted the U.S. in being able to win the Battle of New Orleans. That was 1815. And when, you know, rebuff the British advance. And so Laffite's star did not shine for very long. He got the pardon from Andrew Jackson. He was celebrated, but the people of New Orleans had kind of turned on him at that point. He and the man named Pierre Laffite, who may or may not have been his brother, needed to move. They came to your backyard and set up Maison Rouge and the pirate encampment that was here for those couple of years. And so they were successful. They really had most of their fortunes seized in New Orleans when officials raided Barataria. But by the time they got here, they were a little bit busted. And it was a tough life here, obviously, being, you know, undeveloped, pretty far away from the auctions in New Orleans where they could sell what they had stolen. And so, as you know, the Galveston years didn't really last all that long. And the beauty, I think, of our book, too, is that we don't touch your timeline at all. The New Orleans years, the Galveston years, that's really not what our focus was. Our focus started after Galveston in answering the question, question of what happened. And so Laffite leaves Galveston and heads out into the Gulf. And there's a couple of pings that we have for him. He's in Cuba, he's in Colombia, he's in Mexico. Like, he's a little bit of everywhere. But around 1822, we start to get death theories. He died here of yellow fever. He died over here. It was yellow fever, but it wasn't that year. It was over here. All of these different death theories. The one that you see on the screen here, this one was published in the Gazette de Cartagena. It's one of the more famous death theories that says that he died in a gun battle. He attempted to attack a ship that turned out to be a warship, and that's how he met his demise. We had an opportunity to look at all of those, and I'll let Beth tell you a little bit about some of the conclusions that we drew.
So we had all of these varying theories, and every one of them was sworn by some sort of an expert, so it's not like these had not been studied, but Ashley and I decided that we would lay all of these out on the dining room table and just see if there was a collective thread that ran through all of these varying theories. And we were about that, and I looked at her and said, you know what? A man can only die one time. So if that's the case, then what we're looking at here on this table, all but one of them has to be false, and here's something else. If that many are false, then who's to say all of them are not false, and maybe there is another real true answer that has not even been put forth yet. This was sort of at the beginning of our research. We were beginning to find strange clues in Lincolnton that we knew were leading towards something no one else had discovered. So with that encouragement, and then the realization that we also had all these varying theories, we decided to push ahead. And the picture that is coming up next relates to two men who were very integral in what we were about to discover. The man on the left, Arsène Latour, was an old and dear and very powerful friend of Laffite's. And the man on the right, of course, was Edward Livingston, who was also an old and dear and very powerful friend of Jean Laffite's. He was also his lawyer. Who knew that pirates had lawyers? This one did. And so what we ran across in the course of our studies was a footnote in a book about Latour that spoke of a letter between Latour and Livingston in the year 1829. Now, the last death theory was, and it was sketchy, was what, 1826? Most of them fell within 1822, 23, 24-ish. But here we were in 1829 in Havana, Cuba. Mr. Latour had relocated to Cuba after the Battle of New Orleans. Shortly thereafter, he left New Orleans, left the Gulf Coast, and went to Havana and set up shop down there. So here he was in 1829, writing a letter to Edward Livingston in Washington, saying, oh, by the way, Maison Rouge is down here with me, and he needs your help recovering some of his assets. And his footnote, the book was written by a Frenchman who had recently died, so we could not grab the phone and call the man and say, what did you mean by this? He had put it in a footnote because he was not sure who Maison Rouge was. But we read it and had a fairly decent idea. The problem with that letter was that it was locked away in France in a private collection and would not be available to us so that we could look at the whole thing and see exactly what the context was. Our second plan B option was to go and rummage through Edward Livingston's papers to see if maybe there was another Maison Rouge letter. And I will just tell you up front, Edward Livingston had the worst handwriting in the history of humankind, and ask us how we know that. But we ended up in Princeton, New Jersey, at the Princeton University Library, rummaging through boxes. Nothing had been cataloged, so we weren't sure if we were going to find anything at all. But I will tell you, before I get to the end of the Princeton story, we could have gotten box a little easier than what we got into that library, and this was pre-COVID. There were all kinds of steps we had to go through. We had to go through some kind of a sealed chamber and go into a sealed restroom and wash our hands a certain way and dry our hands a certain way. And then when we came out, you'd think we were going into surgery or something. We had to open the door into the archive room just right, and I didn't do it right, and I got gonged and had to go back and go through. Anyway, long story short, we finally made it into this archive room. And they do have a tremendous collection of very sensitive, very fragile documents there, so we got it. That did not mean that we weren't two Southern girls who didn't know how to behave. So we were in there, and we were rummaging through boxes, and I found a letter, another letter, dated a month later after the French letter. Maison Rouge is still here with me. He needs your help. At that point, we knew what we were looking at.
She's free.
Well,
so I'm on the other side of this research library, and I hear her go, I was like, oh no. She's got something, and this is going to be a scene. She starts to say, Maison Rouge. Maison Rouge. By the end of it, she's yelling at the top of her lungs. Now, let me just say that the Princeton University Library frowns upon shouting in their lovely, very sensitive chamber. And we came this close to getting kicked out, but we had already snapped a picture of the letter, and we're like, kick us out. We don't care. We found.
Really, I was getting ready to hang it off.
Yeah.
When we began looking, we had from the early 1820s up until 1839 when Lorenzo Ferrer appeared in North Carolina. So we had roughly two decades there that were unaccounted for. And we knew that if we, in the course of our research, ran across Jean Laffite and Lorenzo Ferrer, both alive and documented alive at the same time, then we didn't have a story. So what we had found now as a result of Princeton, we had narrowed the window down to one decade, and that's where you're going to pick up the tale and tell what happened next.
So we knew that Lorenzo Ferrer arrived in North Carolina in 1839. We had that 10-year gap, though, that we needed to account for because we just got him through the half year of 1829. We had 10 years to look for. Mississippi was the answer. The very first reference to a man named Lorenzo Ferrer in America came on the 1830 Capaya County census. Capaya County, if you're not familiar, is just south of Jackson. And this took some digging to locate. His name is spelled all kinds of different ways. But at this time in America, he was the only Lorenzo Ferrer in the country. Nobody else with variant spellings of the name or exact spellings of the name were there. What's fascinating to us about this, he was not born in America. He didn't own any property before this in America. He wasn't a member of a church. He wasn't in the newspaper, wasn't a Freemason, didn't do anything to be on the radar. Most interestingly, we know he wasn't born here. He didn't come in from any of the ports. We checked every port record of the day. Nobody named Lorenzo Ferrer had come in. So in 1830, poof, here he is, full-grown man in his 50s. Hi world, I am Lorenzo Ferrer. We had wondered when we first started doing this research, like, how do you go from Cuba and back into America, and why would he have done that if this really was Jean Laffite, because we weren't sure at the time. And the answer, for those of you history buffs, you probably already know, the Mississippi cotton boom was just getting ready to crank up in 1830, and there was a tremendous amount of money to be made under the table, and that was what Jean Laffite was best at doing. And so we believe it was the cotton boom and needing money while he waited for his assets in France to be recovered from the Maison Rouge letter. We believe that that's why he came into Mississippi. What he did once he got there was get into the land speculation game, which was not an altogether honest profession. There was a lot of stuff that was happening there that people selling land that they didn't own the deed to. Just a lot of shady activity, but he also was involved in the slave trade as well, because as the Mississippi cotton boom exploded,
the perceived need for slave labor also rose. And so that's what he was doing down there. He didn't buy a house, he rented. He kept himself completely off the radar in any way that he possibly could. The only documents that we can find are business transactions that happened at Register of Deeds or land offices. And so we tracked him for several years down there, five or six. One of the most interesting things that happened in those years was a couple of things. First, let me skip ahead to tell you this, and then I will go back. He ended up getting married in Mississippi to a very young girl. So he's 56. He marries the 17-year-old daughter of a very prominent businessman in town. His name was Jesse Alford. Her name was Nancy. We had to dig through a spider-infested library in Raymond, Mississippi to find these documents. They were not cataloged and they were not digitized, and so it was a lot of work to get them. But we also learned that their marriage did not last very long. Less than 2 years later, with no divorce, no annulment, and nobody dying, she's married to somebody else and cranking out lots and lots of babies. So we believe that the potential is her family realized, or she learned, that she had accidentally married a pirate who had not been honest about it, and that he was asked to leave town and never come back. He ends up skipping north to another part of Mississippi, which I'll talk about in a second. But before he did that, this was in December 1831, we found a document in Nacogdoches, Texas, that indicates that Ferrer had a business dealing with a man named George Brewer, and the document references the loaning, I guess is the best word, of a slave woman named Louisa, who at the time was 17 years old. Lorenzo Ferrer owned her and allowed the Brewer family to have her for a year. We historically know that when it became illegal in the United States to import new enslaved people, sometimes slave owners had agreements amongst themselves to force slaves that they owned to produce a baby. Because this was for 1 year, it's really crushing to think that that may be what Louisa was loaned for, but there is the potential that it was because Ferrer needed to be out of the country and did not want to take her with him. We're not sure, but remember that name, Louisa. So he skitters on up to Canton, Mississippi, which is just north of Jackson, and resumes his trading and land speculating just like he had done. But we learned from land office records that he met some really important people in Canton. Their last name was Henderson. There were three brothers who had come to Mississippi for the same reason that he had. They were important because one of them went on to become the first governor of Texas, James Pinckney Henderson. Lorenzo Ferrer fell in with them in Canton, Mississippi. They were all doing business together in the land offices there. We have the documents that are all outlined in the book. So those Henderson brothers are there, and it is not long after he meets them that he winds up in Lincolnton, North Carolina. This is significant because, and I'll hand this over to you, this is where the Henderson boys came from, Lincolnton, North Carolina.
So what he did not do, which had caused us a great wonderment for a long time, he did not stand on the square in Canton, Mississippi and throw a dart at a map and say, I think I'll go to Lincoln County, North Carolina next. No, he had good friends in Canton who hailed from Lincoln County, North Carolina, and there were seven more Henderson brothers who were still in Lincoln County, excuse me. And so this is where he landed in the year 1839 with Louisa by his side. We know it is the same girl because her age at her death in North Carolina is exactly the same as what it would have been on this document in Copiah County, Mississippi. So now that he is here, he comes into town. That is the house, Woodside, where the Henderson brothers were all born. That house still stands, and is very much loved and very much alive and well, and it's a great historic landmark there. So here we are in 1839. This mysterious Frenchman arrives with Louisa, with money, a lot of it, and he never worked another day for the next 35 years. This man lived to the age of 96 years. Now, some things sustained him for all of those years, and that is part of what we are continuing to research, but we do know that he had enough money when he came here already to give him a grand start at the very least. What we also noticed in the Lincolnton years was that the same man who had flown completely under the radar in Mississippi, we think for a very good reason, he was not that far removed from his years as Jean Laffite the pirate when he was in Mississippi. There were still men who would have recognized him, who possibly could have turned him in. There were still long memories and the threat of capture or even death. So now that he was in North Carolina, he was more relaxed and was able to sort of come out of his shell and began behaving again more like Laffite had behaved while he was here in Galveston and in New Orleans. He was large and in charge on the public square. He was giving toasts. He was joining a church. He was buying multiple pieces of property. He became politically active. He was joining political committees. So all of a sudden, this very charming, very outgoing personality comes back out. And I will say here, too, there is no photograph of Lorenzo Ferrer, even though he lived to 1875. But what we do have are very consistent eyewitness accounts from the 1810s, the 1820s, the 1840s, 50s, and 60s of people who knew him. Now, the 40s, 50s, and 60s people had not compared notes with the 1810s and the 1820s people, but they all described the exact same man. He was tall, he was handsome, he had a charming personality, he was a fascinating conversationalist, he was witty. All of these things, he was cunning. He had very strong political opinions. He surrounded himself with powerful men who could get him out of jam if he needed one, and he was continually in jam. So all of these characteristics were true, even though they spanned nearly 75 years and were 700 miles apart. One of the most important discoveries we made early on in Lincoln County was the fact that Lorenzo Ferrer had actually formed the Masonic Lodge there in 1852. The name of the lodge was Lincoln Lodge 137. And here is where the story gets very interesting, and I will hand you back over to Ashley.
So this is his lodge petition. We got a tip from a friend in town who was a Freemason at this lodge. Nobody else outside of the Freemasons knew that Lorenzo Ferrer was part of that lodge, so no historian had ever made an attempt to go and look at their records. We got his petition. This is it. The original, it still exists. He was a liar on this document, and the book sort of outlines the way in which he did not tell the truth, but he did not join the lodge as a new Mason. He joined as an existing Mason, except he left off the lodge number of where he had come from, and the place that he said he came from has no record of him. So lots and lots that's shady about that. But we, and I'm still not sure why we thought we could do this, we knocked on their door and said, hey guys, we're researching for a book. Can we come in and see your documents? And they were a little taken aback because nobody had ever asked. And they said, well, yes, we're going to have to take it to a vote. We can't just let you in. And so it had to be a unanimous vote. And they, for some reason, thought we looked legitimate enough to be able to be allowed in. And they opened their ledger book. It started in 1852 and ran, obviously still continuing today, but it ran through a significant portion of years when Lorenzo Ferrer was a member of that lodge and in Lincolnton. What we learned from all of this were all sorts of secrets about every prominent family in town that we were not allowed to talk about any of it, and we won't. We swore that we would only publish and publicly speak about what we learned in reference to Lorenzo Ferrer. And so there were scandals that enveloped many families, financial scandals associated with the lodge. It's very interesting stuff, and we're really grateful that they allowed us to come in. And so just a couple of things before we continue with the really exciting part. The graves that you see here are at St. Luke's Episcopal Church in Lincolnton. That tabletop monument is Lorenzo Ferrer's, one of only two tabletop monuments in Lincoln County, so it's very, very unique. And beside him, the gravestone with the arch, that is Louisa's grave. She died a few years before him. Actually many years before, and she was in her 40s when she passed. And he erected that monument for her. It has a lovely inscription. We are not sure about the relationship that they had. We do know that she was presented in town as his housekeeper, but everybody in town really knew that she was his mistress. And the speculation has always been that they had a child together. His name was Vitinius. There are only two documents in Lincoln County that mention him. One are the records of St. Luke's that list him as a congregant and a slave of Lorenzo Ferrer. The other is Ferrer's will, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But there's never been any actual proof that he was their son. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. The building that you see here is the Pleasant Retreat Academy. This is the building where the Freemasons met in Lorenzo Ferrer's day. Their meeting chamber was up on the second floor. And so we had really exhausted all of what we thought were all of our research options. We got a contract with the University of Louisiana and Lafayette Press. They were concerned that we were going to get scooped with our research because we have a tendency to holler when we find good things in libraries. And they were scared somebody was going to figure out what we had put together and scoop us with an article before we needed the book out. So they were chop-chop, you know, snapping behind us. But we got a call from one of our Freemason brothers a couple of months after we sort of felt finished, but the book had not gone to press yet. And he sort of had alarm in his voice, and he said, "We found something. You need to get up here." So in we go with the boat, and they had this sword laid out on the table. Let me move this. They had a sword laid out on the table. We said, "Well, fellas, what do you have here?" And they said, "This is our Tyler's sword." And at that point, we needed a little bit of education. A Tyler is a position in Freemason Lodge, everyone in America has one, that is appointed and not elected, appointed by the master to be the fellow that stands at the door to guard it, to make sure nobody comes in who's not allowed, whether that's a visiting Mason or whether that's just someone on the street. And the Tyler stands there with the sword. I believe it's a metaphor for guarding the secrets. I don't think they actually like whack people with it or anything. I could be wrong. But they said, "This is our Tyler's sword, and you guys being in here and researching our documents sort of made us think about all of the old things we have, and we were wondering if this could maybe be something." So we used the markings to learn that this was an 1812-1813 cavalry saber from the War of 1812. Made by a man named Nathan Starr, a preeminent sword maker of the day. He had been contracted by the U.S. government to make 5,000 swords for the War of 1812. This is in the second run of swords. The first 1,000 had a leather scabbard. This one has iron, so it was part of the later run. And we had scoured the minutes of the lodge and had not seen any mention of this sword being donated, which is odd, because they cataloged every single thing that ever came into that lodge. So you'd see a notation like, "Brother so-and-so donated 4 candles, but one of them was kind of broken, so it was really only 3 candles." And yet, we have a sword that's been there as long as anybody can remember, hanging on 2 rusty nails, and there's no documentation of when it came in. We also learned that of the very small group of founding brothers in that lodge, none of them had more of 1812 connections, either personally or family-wise, except except for Lorenzo Ferrer, who we knew at that point was Jean Laffite. So we were ecstatic and went home, you know, thinking, all right, we got a period sword that there's no explanation otherwise for how it got there. This is very exciting. Me being a little loopy, I couldn't sleep because I may or may not have held a pirate sword, and my brain was just, you know, going 90 miles an hour, and I thought, as I couldn't sleep that night, you know, we didn't look at that scabbard very closely. We were really focused on the sword. I wonder if there's more to this than we initially realized. And so I called first asked my husband if we had a black light. You should have seen the look on his face. He knew I hadn't slept, and, you know, I'm asking for a black light. He's like, what did you do tonight? No, it's not that. This is for historical research. And so we got voted in again to come the next day to look, and I brought the black light, which he had, which makes me sort of question why he had it. But anyway, we go in, the lights go down, I'm holding the black light, and one of the youngest brothers in the lodge is leaned down. He's got young, fresh eyeballs. He's looking, and all at the same time, we sort of see the area of the sword that was of interest. And this is a picture from the day that we made the discovery. And so we said, all right, Linda, and that was his name, what do you see? And he said, I see letters. We said, tell us what letters you see. And mind you, Linda didn't, he'd not done any of this research. He didn't know what he was looking for. He said, I see a capital J. Uh-huh. I see a lowercase n. And then I see a space. And then I see a capital L. He needed to say no other letters because we nearly fainted. We knew what the remaining letters were going to be. A-F-F-I-T-E. Jean Laffite had hand-etched his signature into the scabbard of his sword, and they had absolutely no idea. There's a reason for that. We knew that we had to have this verified by some really top-notch experts, because you don't just come out with something like this without people saying, oh, you planted the sword, you hand-etched that signature yourself. We knew we needed proof. So it took a while. We consulted with the Smithsonian, the Metropolitan Museum of Art, Colonial Williamsburg. They helped us find an antique armor expert who allowed us in. The sword had to travel with a mason. It's not allowed to leave their custody. And we had to get a big boat to be able to take it out of the building and take it to an expert. This is Brent Turner. He's one of the masons that helped us get in. This is the day we had it verified. And so this expert was able to tell us some very important things. First, the sword was thought like we had determined it correctly based on its markings. Next, the sword had a very heavy coating of oil or varnish placed on it a long, long time ago. The signature is underneath it. So he says, I can look at this thing under the microscope and see that the etching is under the oil. And he said, that oil has been there a long, long time. He said, probably as old as the sword itself. So it's an old signature under an old coating of oil. It was such a heavy coating that it filled in the cracks of some of the signature, and that's why you can't see it very well. All of these sort of details, he also saw the letters that we saw. He said, I can see it clear as day, J.M. Laffite. And he said, I can also, under this microscope, see that the intentional hand etching is deep and much more intentional than the surface nicks and dings that are absolutely all over the sword. And so he said, I see what you see. It's old. I'll put my name on it. This was the piece of evidence that really, we believed it already, but this was the main piece of evidence that proved to us that Lorenzo Ferrer, who came to Lincolnton in 1839, was Jean Laffite. We found his sword somehow. It was really remarkable. But a few more things, and then we'll tell you about some of the new things we found since the book has come out, and I'll let Beth tell you about those.
The document that you're looking at here is a ballad, a handwritten ballad that was found in Ferrer's house after he died. And someone carefully put it away and made a notation of where they found it. During the course of our research, we read this thing and realized that it may not have ever been published. Ashley, with her connections in the literary world and as an English professor, checked with some of her colleagues who had access to databases of every published work that had ever been published, and they ran this ballad through their database and said that it was unpublished. Their conclusion was that it's likely one of those ballads that was composed around and meant to be recited or sung around a campfire. Apparently these were very common back in the early 1800s and leading all the way up to the Civil War. What was remarkable about this one was that this is an account, and it was written apparently in real time, as in what he was writing about had not yet come to a conclusion. This writer was writing about the Battle of Pensacola and possibly elements of the Battle of New Orleans. This was a hero worship piece about Andrew Jackson, and there is no signature on this ballad. We have since analyzed it a little bit, and we are still in the process of conducting spectral analysis on it. The experts that have looked at it so far say that it is old paper, very old paper, and very good paper. And what we found, and this is sort of a new development, we have published it in, published a paper on it in our Journal of Lafayette Studies, and we'll tell you a little more about that in a few minutes. But we had concluded a presentation just like this in Lincolnton, and this document was on display there. And so we were carefully trying to put it away, and there were only two or three people in the room, and Ashley said, hang on a minute. We looked, and in the lower 1/8 quadrant, the bottom of this thing, on the back of it, where part of the last few verses were written, down at the very bottom was some very, very faint, faded pencil writing. But you could see that something had been written there, but you couldn't tell what. And so that launched us on a journey that is still continuing. We've been working with an expert in spectral analysis who is getting ready, we think, to apply yet another process and try to determine. We've already determined we're pretty sure what the top line is, and I don't know, we can't tell you, but it's very promising and points right back to the theory of the book, so I'll leave it at that. The other documents that are very pertinent to Ferrer, I told you that he arrived with money in 1839 and that he never worked a day. When he died, he left a 3-page will, and there's an entire chapter in the book about this will. He left various sums of money to all sorts of different people, right down to the man who used to sell him vegetables. So, very intriguing document, and some very intriguing clues about Mississippi in this document as well. And of course, you know, we were the ones who found Mississippi and did not realize the connection until we began looking at this. So, very interesting. Latinius Ferrer is mentioned in here as his former slave, and he left him $100. To our knowledge, Latinius never returned to town. He had already left town by the time Ferrer died. He did not return to claim his $100. But there was a sizable amount of money, upwards of $5,000 or $6,000 in this estate, and that's in 1875 money. So he died with money, and we're not totally sure that that's all the man died with. There likely was very much more. So anyway, that sort of concludes some of the documentation that we found and brings you to the end of the tale. And we have some new developments that we'd like to talk about, and I'll hand this back to you for that.
And we'll make this brief. A couple of the new developments that we have discovered here lately, or a new development in our process, I should say, is that we have formed the Jean Laffite Historical Society. And the reason we did this is because when we were doing our research, it would have been very helpful if there had been sort of a central clearinghouse, a place where we could have gone to find really reliable information about Laffite, because there's a lot of misinformation out there. And so we decided to form a very welcoming and inclusive group that can help us in that regard. And so we were very, very happy to find the work of Pam Keyes, who has since passed on, but she was a scholar who did a ton of work about Laffite that was so beneficial. But what we wanted was other scholars to actually have a place that they could go. And so part of the foundation of what we wanted to produce here, we believe that there's a difference between findings and arguments, right? Findings are people who do active research, locate documents, and then publish what they found so that other people can draw conclusions along with them. Arguments are generally made by people who read the work that other people are doing and then sit around and quibble about those arguments, right? And that's generally not very productive. We wanted a group that focused on findings. So if you're interested in joining for free a very active group of scholars who does instead of talks, please consider joining. You can send an email to JeanLaffiteRevealed@gmail.com. We do Zoom meetings. In fact, most of our membership comes from other states, and we like that because Jean Laffite history isn't owned by anybody, right? We've got his body, but North Carolina doesn't own him. So much happened in New Orleans, but New Orleans doesn't own him, and so much happened here, but Galveston doesn't own him. We aren't going to find the remaining things that are to be located about him unless we are all working together, and that we can all, even if we disagree about some things, we can still sort of make a cohesive group and continue to push forward with findings and not just arguments. So if you're interested in joining us, we're fun people, and we have a lot of neat things in store. We're also publishing a journal, so there's opportunity, and that sounds sort of hoity-toity, it's not. There's an opportunity for people to write short white papers as they make findings, and we published our first edition this fall.
And speaking of findings, right out of the gate, one of our new members called one day and said, I think I found Phineas Ferrer. And we were all over it, got in touch with the girl. What she had decided to do as a result of our first meeting was just a general genealogical search, which we had done, a lot of people had done, nothing had turned up. She turned up a death certificate in Boston, which indicates that a man named Augustus Ferrer died there in the year 1913, and on his death certificate, a friend of his helped to fill out the information. The friend said that Augustus had parents named Lorenzo Ferrer and Louisa. There is a discrepancy, however, because Lorenzo and Louisa are both listed as having been born in France. Now, the gravestone that you saw a few slides back, where Ferrer had left a very beautiful message about Louisa, indicated that she was born in Richmond, Virginia. So there again, you can't be born both in Richmond, Virginia and France, and we're working through those discrepancies. What we do know is that if this is Vitinius, then like father, like son, he reinvented himself, he gave himself a new name, and likely even lied about the birthplace of his mother on his death certificate. So the plot thickens, and we had scheduled a trip to Boston in September, but their archives are not open yet, and so we've had to delay that until after the first of the year. But this is just a wonderful example of a new development, a new finding, and a way that anyone can become involved with a little bit of hard work. We solicited a white paper from her, and it was published in our first edition of the Journal of Laffite Studies.
What's also exciting about this is it raises the potential for DNA analysis. We are not advocates for digging up bodies for no good reason, but if we can locate where Vitinius is buried, and we have a very good idea, we believe he was buried in an unmarked grave, so it's going to take some time to locate, but this could potentially lead to some DNA connections, which is exciting, so we'll see where that goes. Another, and I'm going to have to read this to you because I think the font is too big for the screen. Just a couple of weeks ago, we came upon a quote in a Lincoln County document that had not been discovered before. And this is one of those, another example, I should say, of there are things still to be discovered, and we're still finding them and continually astonished. We found a quote from the diary of David Schenck, dated 1852. Lorenzo Ferrer was alive then. This was the year that the lodge was formed. In his diary, David Schenck wrote, "There was an infidel out by the name of Ferrier, a Frenchman, but he is very respectable and intimate with Mr. Lander," he's a pastor, Samuel Lander in Lincolnton, "who preached, and it was that brought him out." So this quote indicates for us, and we knew there were some local scandals related to Ferrer, but this is sort of solidifies that other people in town were familiar with it, and that Ferrer's relationship with a very upstanding citizen named Samuel Lander is the thing that made everybody in town think, all right, he's probably an infidel, and that word is very important. There's lots of 1800s connotations for that. But his relationship with this powerful, important person sort of makes us be willing to not think about that. And so the use of that word infidel and what that implies that he was doing is something that we're continuing to explore.
Another new development that has just come to our doorstep recently is the realization that Edward Livingston may not have been the sole source of recovery for Laffite's funds from France. We have an international lead that indicates there may have been another player involved in that. And there again, until we know for sure, we really can't give you that name, but it is one that's well known to you guys. So we'll leave it at that and just know that that work is ongoing as well. All of this is sort of wrapped up in the next book that we're writing. And so we will be seeing it. And that's another reason we can't tell you everything. But anyway, that is yet another. We have one more.
I think that you kind of talked about both of them sort of together. So.
I will elaborate.
So the sort of international connections are related to a larger plot of which Lorenzo Ferrer, Jean Laffite, was only one player. So we really, as we were doing our research, we recognized that there were some peripheral things, some other players that were possibly a part of something here. But after the book has come out, we've realized that there was a lot of other stuff that went not just local, it went national and it went international. And so we are currently investigating some plots that would kind of blow your mind. And we are working to get documented proof to establish it so that we're not just coming out with theories, that we actually have some proof. And so we can say that some of the things we're finding are pretty exciting. So we'll leave it at that. But as my mom said, we do have a Jean Laffite Revealed sequel coming soon. We are actively writing. In fact, we have been researching for the past 2 days in undisclosed locations. And we had to stop posting because there were people like on our trail trying to find the libraries where we were. So we have to zip our lips now and not post about the barbecue wherever we are. Because they're like, okay, triangulate our barbecue restaurants and figure out which libraries we went to. So we will conclude, however, by encouraging you to come into the room here on the side. We'll be happy to sign books for you. And even if you brought your book and want us to sign it, we'll be happy, obviously, to do that. But if you, with the holidays coming, know of any history buffs who'd like to read, we would be really happy to autograph and describe the book to them so that you could give any of our books as Christmas gifts. But we appreciate your attention. We are so happy to be here. We love it here. And we hope we delivered a presentation that you enjoyed. So thank you. And I will give us just a moment to scoot up the middle aisle like the bride and the groom escaping the wedding before you come in. We'd appreciate it.